A very good afternoon to all of you, respected member secretary, speaker, sir, president, and my dear seniors and staffs, and all of you a very good afternoon. I, Sapam Ranbir Singh, feel privileged to extend my warm welcomes to all of you on this 9 Nirmal Kumar Memorial Bose Lecture. So far, 8 memorial lecture has been delivered by eminent anthropologists, archaeologists, freedom fighters, and social activists. Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, along with its diverse programs, initiated some memorial lecture series in honor of renowned scholars who have done singular service and made path-breaking contributions in different fields of study and whose academic approach and directions are direct relevance to the conceptual base of the agency. Nirmal Kumar Bose, one of the India's greatest sons, a humanist, a Gandhian, and a renowned anthropologist of whom social reconstruction was more important than building social theories, was a carryover of the 19th century Renaissance in Bengal. He was a great mind, a great visionary who was never confined to the conventional boundaries of an academic discipline, be it anthropology, geography, geology, prehistory, archaeology, and even Gandhiology. Professor Bose used anthropology to demonstrate India's unity in the diversity of culture. This year, we are having an eminent anthropologist, Professor Nadeem Hasnain, as the speaker, and Professor T.V. Kattimani, Vice Chancellor Indira Gandhi National Tribal University, as the chairperson. I request both the speaker and the chairperson to take the seat on the dais. Please, sir. Professor Nadeem Hasnain has been a professor of social anthropology and head Department of Anthropology at the University of Lucknow. Professor Hasnain has served as Fulbright Scholar in Residence and visiting professor at the St. Lawrence University in New York State. He served as a Pro Vice Chancellor of Mahatma Gandhi Antarashtriya Hindi Vishwavidyalaya at Central University in Wardha, Maharashtra, where he founded a new Department of Anthropology in 2010. His areas of interest and specialization are tribal studies, anthropology of slum, social change in India, issues related to Dalits, OBC, religious minorities, and women's studies. His last assignment is of Senior Fellow, Indian Council of Social Science Research. We welcome you, sir. Today's chairperson is Professor T.V. Kattimani. He is the Vice Chancellor of Indira Gandhi National Tribal University, Amarkantak, Madhya Pradesh. He is a renowned scholar of linguistics and Indology. Professor Kattimani has also associated with several institutes in various capacities. He has many articles and books in his credit. Thank you very much, sir. We welcome you, sir. Like every other auspicious occasions, let's start this event by offering our prayer to Ma Saraswati, the embodiment of knowledge, and conduct our customary lamp lighting ceremony as a tribute to Goddess Saraswati. For this, I will request our respected member secretary, Dr. Sachidanan Joshi, and speaker, Professor Nadeem Hasnain, Professor T.V. Kattimani, Molly Ma'am, HODJS Division, and Dr. Ramakar Pant to come up on stage and light the inaugural lamp.
Om Shubham Karoti Kalyanam Arogyam Dhanam Sampadah Atma Buddhi Prakashaya Deepajyotirnamostute Deepatvam Dehi Kalyanam Dehi Sarvan Manorathan Yavat Karam Samapyeta Tavat Tvam Susthiro Bhava.
May I now request our member secretary, Dr. Sachidanan Joshi, sir, to facilitate both the guests. And also I take this opportunity to release a printed booklet of today's lecture. May I now request Member Secretary, Dr. Sajan Sosisa, to deliver the welcome address.
Most respected Professor Nadeem Hasnain, the speaker of today's lecture, the chair of this lecture, my dear friend, Vice Chancellor of Indira Gandhi National Tribal University, Professor Katimaniji, distinguished audience, my dear colleagues at the IGNCA. It is our privilege to be here today for this ninth lecture on N.K. Bose Memorial Lecture. We all know that N.K. Bose was a multifaceted personality and he was never confined to the conventional boundary of an academic discipline, be it anthropology, be it geography, genealogy, prehistory, archaeology, and even Gandhiology. So he was a multifaceted personality. And our Janapad Sampada division organized memorial lecture, and we are doing it since 1993. Every 2 years we normally do this lecture. So this is the ninth lecture in this series. And we had eminent speakers like Surjit Chandra Sinha ji, Birendra Kumar Bhattacharya ji, M.K. Dhaki ji, T.N. Pandey ji, A.C. Bhagwati ji, Lakshman Kumar Mahapatra ji, R.S. Negi ji, P.K. Mishra ji. And today in this illustrious list, we are also going to listen to Professor Nadeem Hasnain's lecture, which is on a very important topic, the first citizen, the tribal people at the crossroads. And I know that this particular topic creates interest in more than one way. And I know that academicians, not only academicians, but social researchers and administrators, they all are keen to deliberate on this topic. Sir, I had a chance to be at Raipur for 10 years as Vice Chancellor, which was a very predominantly tribal-dominated state of Chhattisgarh. And I could also witness some of the problems related to tribal people in the southern and northern part of the Chhattisgarh, which you all know. So when we discuss about the tribal problem, the tribal population, even people like us who were staying at Raipur were also were very, very concerned and very curious on the issues. So today's topic, which you are going to discuss and deliver, is going to be very interesting and an eye-opener for all of us, I'm sure. And I'm happy that the Vice Chancellor of Tribal University is there to chair this session. So it is not only an academic exercise, but maybe we can also draw some kind of an action plan through this deliberation. We have Janapad Sampada division with us, and sir, you would also recollect that we have a memorandum of understanding with your university, which we are going to use in more than one ways to do something concrete. I would also like to request my Janapad Sampada division that since we are an academic institution at the IGNCA, doing this memorial lecture in 2 years span is too much of a time. Memorial lecture can be repeated every year. So if our Janapad Sampada division takes this challenge to organize this lecture every year, I would be more than happy to do that as the institutional head and as an academician and a scholar. So I hope that maybe from the next year onwards, we would have this as an yearly exercise so that eminent persons like Nadeem Hasnain or Professor Katimaniji could be invited every year to deliberate and deliver their lectures on different issues. I welcome you all, especially Professor Nadeem Hasnain, about whom I have heard a lot through one of my common friends. He has been telling a lot about Professor Hasnain, but I had a chance to meet him only today. And I'm also very happy that Professor Kattimani finally could make it to IGNCA. We have been trying to invite him in several other functions, but he couldn't make it. But today, I'm happy that he is here. He is more busy than any president or prime minister. He had three programs today. But still I'm happy that only because of our good friendship, he's here. And I also welcome the audience here who are here in good numbers. And I'm really happy to see quite a few young people to listen to this lecture, which is very encouraging. Because normally such lectures are attended by gray-haired people or or people who have darkened their hair by some color or something like that. But today we are having genuinely black-haired people, which is encouraging. So this is a good sign as far as academics is concerned. And I hope that next year, if we convene this lecture, we should not convene it in this lecture room, but in the auditorium of IGNCA, which has a capacity of more than 250 people. So thank you very much. And once again, welcome to you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your thought-provoking address. Now I request Professor Kattimani to take the charge of today's memory lecture, proceedings of today's memory lecture.
I request Professor Hasnain, Nadeem Hasnain, to take the charge.
Before I read the text of my lecture, I want to see two favors from you, sir, Mr. Chairman. One is that because of my recent illness, my energy level is very low, and I cannot stand there on the dais, so allow me to speak from this dais. And secondly, I may not be able to read the entire text. So please allow me to read as many pages as I can. And then our colleague from the IGNCA, Shatabdi, then she will take over and she will complete the lecture. Thank you, sir. I feel honored to have been invited by the authorities of the Indira Gandhi National Center of Arts to deliver Nirmal Kumar Bose Memorial Lecture. Memorial lecture, even otherwise, is an appropriate way to remember this great son of India. As a student of anthropology, I find him a unique anthropologist in the Gandhian mold. His versatility was amazing. He wrote on social cultural anthropology, prehistoric archaeology, temple architecture, geology, human geography, social history, politics, education, social work, and one of his favorite subjects, Gandhiism. His tenure at the Anthropological Survey of India as director gave a new direction to this organization and brought several laurels for it. He was an extraordinary and complex personality. I have chosen a topic from an area. Am I audible clearly till the last row? I have chosen a topic from an area that is tribal studies, which was very close to his heart. Borrowing from the title of the latest book of Meena Radhakrishnan, a fellow sociologist, I have described our tribal citizens as first citizens, whose well-being is not only our constitutional obligation, but also a civilizational obligation. Constituting a little above 8% of the total population, which in terms of absolute numbers is quite a large population. In fact, India has second largest population in the world, second only to Africa. The scheduled tribes and other tribal communities are facing the most difficult times in the post-independence era. Before analyzing the problems being faced by the tribal communities and their dilemmas, along with the dilemmas of the state, it should be worthwhile to revisit Jawaharlal Nehru's vision for our first citizens, and the state's obligation contained in his now forgotten Panchsheel, the five-point agenda. It says, first, that tribal people should develop along the lines of their own genius, and we should avoid imposing anything on them. We should try to encourage in every way their own traditional arts and culture. Second, tribal rights in land and forests should be respected. Third, we should try to train and build up teams of their own people to do the work of administration and development. Some technical personnel from outside will no doubt be needed, but we should avoid introducing too many outsiders in their areas. We should not over-administer their areas or overwhelm them with a multiplicity of schemes. We should rather work through and not in rivalry to their own social and cultural institutions. And the fifth one is, we should judge the results not by statistics or the amount of money spent, but by the quality of the character that is involved. To some, a Panchsheel of Nehru may sound too idealistic, impractical, and some of the ideas are out of tune with the present times. To some extent, it may be correct. But if you look at the spirit and the ethos of Panchsheel, it will still provide us a positive and humane roadmap to formulate a structure of remedial measures. Now I propose to look at the problems being faced by our tribal brethren in the light of Nehru's vision and what has happened in the post-independence period. Knowing differently, in the process of educating, quote and unquote, modernizing, quote and unquote, and mainstreaming, quote and unquote, the tribal communities, the state policies have completely ignored that the tribal people have a wonderful and rich repertoire of indigenous knowledge system. Endowed with an amazing knowledge about environment and ecology, flora, fauna, marine life, herbal or ethnomedicine, they lived through their outstanding and rich arts and crafts. When the last tsunami hit the coast of India in 2004, thousands of people were killed and devastated. But some of the most primitive tribes of the world, the scheduled tribes of Andaman and Nicobar Islands, survived with minimal losses because of their amazing knowledge of ocean and marine life. While the highly scientifically and technologically advanced countries of the world had to suffer huge losses in life and property because they failed to apprehend the coming catastrophe. After persistent persuasion and lobbying, the Indian Council of Medical Research established a research center in tribal medicine to preserve and document this knowledge, while the agencies of Western countries have been trying to patent a number of such herbal or ethnomedicines in the face of indifferent attitude of our own governmental agencies. Thus, we are in the process of rediscovering a number of areas of knowledge through which our tribal communities have been living happily without the help of our modern institutions. The declining Adivasi knowledge system is related with the systematic killings of the linguistic diversity. As rightly pointed out by Anvita Abbi, 2012, we have to face the bad consequences for homogenization of languages being undertaken in the name of developing the tribes. Adivasis are being forced to forget their indigenous languages as education, even at the primary level, is imparted in the dominant state languages. Tragically, the tribal language, education, and language is stigmatized, and the Adivasis are being made to feel ashamed, and they have stopped taking pride in their languages. In this process, their traditional knowledge is now easily forgotten. By ignoring the linguistic human rights of education, we are depriving the tribes of building their intangible assets of capital. In the wake of displacement from their habitats and violence and counter-violence, a language first declines and then lost. Bastar is the classical example of this situation. Extinction of a speech, dialect or language means the loss of centuries of old traditions and sanskars. as Pankaj Chaturvedi 2017 documents, till 1960s, 36 languages were alive in Bastar region. Every tribal community and craftsman had their own language, while Halbi was the language of administration. Gondi was dominant in forests. Even Gondi had several versions and variations. Now the number of its speaker is reduced to just around 500. In the wake of large-scale migration, mechanization and market, a number of handicrafts have also become extinct along with the associated languages or got assimilated with the neighboring dominant languages. In a way, Bastar has become a graveyard of languages. Death of a speech means the extinction and disappearance of the associated culture, folk behavior, identity, and indigenous knowledge. Linguists of the world over are of the view that development of a human group or community is linked to the use of indigenous knowledge base, which is stored in the native language. If we deprive the tribes of their base in their ancient and traditional culture and languages, how can they be creative and innovative? The two mantras of development. Instead of the wholesale replacement, what is desirable to be achieved is modernization of tradition. We don't have to forget that those who think and know differently are to be respected and not to be denigrated. Perhaps that is what Nehru meant in his first point of Panchsheel, that is, the tribal people should develop along the lines of their own genius, and we should avoid imposing anything on them. This takes us to the old debate, assimilation versus integration. Sociologists such as G.S. Ghurye and Gandhians such as Thakkar Bapa wanted our tribal communities to be assimilated with their neighboring Hindu populations. G.S. Ghurye described them as backward Hindus and hence justifying their assimilation. Such a coercive assimilation or acculturation goes against the spirit of Indian civilization and our constitution. When in this country, a Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Christian, a Telugu, Tamil, Uriya, Bengali and others have the right to live along their identities with honor and dignity, enjoying cultural autonomy, then why the tribal communities cannot exist with the same amount of honor and dignity as a Santhal, Gond, Bhil, Khasi, and Mizo? For many of us, India is not a melting pot of races and cultures, but a salad bowl where each ingredient, though mixed up, still retains its identity and flavor. Thus, integration and not assimilation should be our commitment. That was the first part of the lecture. Now, I want the remaining to be read by Shatabdi.
Formal education has made substantial headway among the tribal groups only since recent decades. In the light of the past efforts, it's not shocking because prior to 1950, the government of India had hardly any direct program for the education of the tribal people. With the adoption of the constitution, the promotion of education of scheduled tribes has become a special responsibility of the central as well as of the state government. The growth of the formal education among the tribal populations of the country may be gauged from the facts yielded by the census data. This percentage rose to 32.60% in 1991 against 52.2% for the entire country. The literacy rate among the tribal women is obviously much lower. So the total picture of spread of education among the tribal communities is not very encouraging, barring a few tribes of the northeastern region like the Khasi, the Garo, the Mizos, etc., who tremendously benefited from the vast network of Christian missionary institutions. In fact, Christianity has been the earliest welfare agency in northeastern region. Since education is probably the most effective instrument for ensuring equality of opportunity and also a great leveler, the tribal people are lagging far behind their more fortunate fellow citizens, even behind the scheduled castes due to lack of education. Let us analyze the main reasons for this state of affairs. Social factors. Allocation of funds and opening of schools do not go far in providing education to the tribal people. Socio-cultural factors play a very important role in this respect. Formal education has not been necessary for the members of the tribal societies for a long time to discharge their social and economic obligations. Hence, they should have been prepared to accept education, and it should be presented to them in such a way as to cut the barriers of superstition and prejudice. Barring the tribal communities of northeastern region, it is still a widespread feeling among the tribal people that education makes their boys defiant and insolent and alienates them from the rest of their society, while the girls turn modern, quote-unquote, and go astray, quote-unquote. Since some of their educated boys felt alienated and cut off their links with their families and villages after getting education and good employment, some of the tribal groups vehemently opposed the spread of education in their midst. Besides, some of their superstitions and myths also play their part. Some tribal groups believe that their gods shall be angry if they send their children to school run by quote-unquote outsiders. Economic factors. Some economic factors too are responsible for lack of interest shown by the tribal people in getting education. Since most of the tribal people are living in an abject poverty under subsistence economy, it is not easy for most of them to send their children to schools, thus losing two healthy hands in their struggle for survival. What Verrier Elwin, 1963, said about 50 years ago very appropriately sums up the present situation, quote, "For a tribal family, to send its grown-up girl or a boy to school is essentially a matter of economics and entails dislocation in the traditional pattern of division of labor. Many parents cannot just afford to send their children to school," quotes. A number of other scholars also support this view by saying that poor economic condition of the tribal societies is a great hindrance to successful education. Almost all the tribes, whether food gatherers, hunters, fishermen, shifting cultivators, or settled agriculturalists, lack enough food to maintain the family for the whole year. Education, therefore, is a luxury to them which they can hardly afford. Each school-going child in tribal family is an economic unit and contributes to the family income. If the child is taken away from his normal economic work to attend school, the family is deprived of the little income which he brings. Instead, the parents have to feed the child out of their earnings, which further reduces the economic stability of the family. According to the parent system of present system of education, any economic benefit a tribal child can bring to his family will be only after 10 or 15 years of schooling. The parents had neither the patience nor the foresight to wait for such a long period. They can, however, be convinced easily if the education for them can be made productive right from the beginning. Lack of interest in formal education. B.D. Sharma, even in 1976, had already pointed out that the quote-unquote urban middle class-oriented educational system has got superimposed on the entire nation, both in terms of the structure and content. In many states, tribal children are taught through the same books which form the curriculum of non-tribal children of the urban and rural areas of the rest of the state. Obviously, the content of such books rarely appeals the tribal children who come from different cultural backgrounds. Stories of scientific and technological progress, founders of modern India, history and geography of the country, etc., of course, form necessary part of any curriculum, but the situation demands that their education should start with the teaching of demography, history and ecology of their own region, their neighborhood and the state. National consciousness should not be imposed from above or inside, but they should be made aware of it in a systematic manner. The tribal child who lives in an isolated and far-off place, untouched by the currents of modern civilization, can hardly assimilate any information about history and geography of the country, about the industrial and technical development, uninteresting and outdated stories, and about the important personalities unknown and unheard of in tribal areas. He has to be given a complete information about his neighboring communities, his village life, social organization, belief and practices, and then pass on to the national scene where he can introduce himself to India, which is his country. Then only he can be able to grasp what is happening in his village, in his state, in his country, and if possible, in other countries of the world. This is a well-known fact that education in India has spread in a haphazard way without taking care of future needs. Tribal education also could not escape this anomaly and became instant failure due to apathy, indifference, and lack of interest of tribal people in formal education. S.N. Rath, a senior and well-known expert, had put forward the following scheme, which is not only recommendatory in nature, but also analyzes the malady with clarity. Point one, under the traditional tribal setup, a child enters adulthood with confidence. He knows his environment thoroughly, knows how to construct his own house, cultivate his field, weave his cloth. In short, he acquired all the skills to lead a reasonably comfortable life within the limitations of his culture. The simple skill of reading and writing acquired in an over-formal school is no match for this. We cannot afford to push him to go back to his environment naked. Therefore, a balance should be struck somewhere to evolve a system of curricula where the tribal school, in addition being a part of the national scheme, should have a supplementary curriculum adapted to the specific local conditions. Second point, the supplementary curriculum should be biased towards crafts and should inculcate a sense of dignity of labor, qualities of cooperation, and social discipline. Certain activities like agriculture, dancing, hunting, tribal games, and archery must be allowed to find fullest expression in the extracurricular activities of the school, thus providing some continuity of the traditional values and forms of organization. Third point, a scheme is to be worked out through which the school children shall be able to link up the school and the teacher with their parents and the tribal activities. The school has to act as a center of disposal of simple technical know-how beyond the skills of reading and writing and become an effective agent of social change. The student-teacher-parent continuum should be able to generate a congenial atmosphere so that the broad purpose of education, which is to enable an average citizen to comprehend the social, political, economic, and other processes and forces around him, is fully served. The fourth and the last point, needless to say, this utopian scheme largely depends upon suitably trained and dedicated teachers. Role of teachers. Lack of suitable teachers for the first few decades after the independence is one of the major reasons for the slow growth of education in tribal areas. Most of the teachers employed for imparting education to the tribal children showed little appreciation of the tribal way of life and value system. They approached the tribal people with a sense of superiority and treat them as quote-unquote savage and quote-unquote uncivilized, and hence fail to establish proper rapport with their students. A teacher in the tribal areas must have a thorough knowledge of tribal system and culture. He or she must speak the tribal language. Only then the teacher can be in a position to act as a friend, philosopher, and guide to the tribal people. Actually, the gulf between teacher and the taught can be best reduced by appointing teachers from the tribal community itself or a separate cadre of teachers for the tribal areas with some inducements should be created to serve the educational needs of the tribal society. However, in the northeastern region, there were always local teachers. Lack of facilities. One of the major problems in tribal education is that of language. Most of the tribal language and dialects are in the most rudimentary stage, and there is little or there is little any written literature. Hence, the problem of medium of instruction has been a great irritant. Most of the states impart education to tribal and non-tribal children alike through the medium of the regional language, thus making education uninteresting to many of the tribal people. It also hurts tribal sentiments for his own language. Hence, some way out has to be found out to make education meaningful and productive for the tribal people. Nature of habitat for the tribals is also responsible for slow growth of education. Most of the tribal villages are scattered. This entails long travels to attend schools. Unless the school is situated very close to their villages and its site approved by the local people, the result shall not be encouraging. School building, in some cases, also plays an important role in the growth of education among the tribal fold. Due to mismanagement, bungling, and sometimes financial constraints, the building is seldom suitable to run an educational institution. S. N. Rath, 1981, has given that dilapidated, often roofless structures standing as lone sentinels in the midst of a featureless spot away from the village are often pointed out as schools. Another factor related with the problem is the number of teachers. Most primary schools in tribal areas are quote-unquote single teacher managed, whose presence in the school is more than an exception than a rule. Overburdening may be one of the possible factors for this state of affairs. It will be unjust to expect a teacher to follow a non-stop 6-hourly schedule of teaching as a matter of daily routine. The enthusiasm of tribal people in the education of their children also depends considerably on the timing of the school hours in different seasons. The school timings should not clash with their important socio-economic activities and events. People running schools for the tribal communities often have killed their Adivasis' interest in education by their unimaginative planning. Local conditions and requirements of the people should get top priority in any scheme for running these schools, and a balance has to be maintained between the needs of the family and the needs of education. Stagnation and wastage. To many observers of the situation, the problem of education in tribal areas was the problem of wastage. It is not that wastage and stagnation are peculiar to the tribal communities alone, but the extent of wastage is much larger in their case. The problem of absenteeism is a serious one in tribal areas. One sees a large number of students on rolls, but the actual attendance is really low. And the number of students passing out at the final examinations is even lower. The real problem is to create such economic conditions as could be conducive to the students developing sufficient interest in their studies. The next point is indebtedness, land alienation, and forest-related issues. Indebtedness. The chronic indebtedness has been and still is probably the most difficult problem facing almost the entire tribal population of India. Consequently, one of the worst forms of exploitation to which the tribal people are exposed is through traditional money lending. Barring certain communities in the northeastern region, which were close to the middlemen and contractors during British rule, indebtedness is quite widespread and crushing among almost the entire Indian tribes. The chronic indebtedness of the tribal people is certainly due to rampant poverty and deficit economy. Reliable ethnographic evidence provide that the tribal people were certainly not that much handicapped in the struggle for living a carefree life when their places of habitation were isolated and devoid of middlemen and contractors. They were living in self-sufficient economic conditions. Forest wealth was at their disposal to sustain themselves. But unfortunately, when their abodes were thrown open as a result of economic development all around, they found themselves completely ill-equipped to enjoy the fruits of development. Outsiders, those so-called civilized people, exploited their vulnerability in the absence of any concerted efforts on the part of the administration. With the passage of time, their plight continued to worsen, and they have been reduced to the position in which we find them today. Also, we have little scientific data about the extent of their indebtedness. It is obvious that the size of the problem is enormous. Indebtedness among them does not have only economic dimensions, but social and psychological too. For a large number, happiness and peace desert them. For others, it makes the entire system impervious to hope. In many areas, it leads to bondedness or debt bondage due to the debt descending from father to son and even to the successive generations. Hasnain, revised edition 2012, has made a significant study of this vicious cycle of debt bondage. Among a large number of tribal people, indebtedness has become unavoidable and thus normal phenomenon of their existence. Following are some of the important reasons of indebtedness common to almost all the affected groups. loss of tribal rights over land and forests, poor and primitive mode of agriculture resulting in deficit supply of food grains, ignorance, expenditure beyond their means due to extravagant spendings on marriages, deaths, fairs, and festivals, fatalist attitude and locally oriented worldview, and adherence to panchayat decisions regarding fines for fear of excommunication. Due to the above mentioned points, he is always in need of money and thus becomes an easy victim of exploitation by unscrupulous money lenders and middlemen. Small amounts borrowed at usurious rates of interest from time to time snowball into a sum beyond his capacity and capacity to repay, and what little he possesses by way of land is snatched by the money lender. No program of economic development is likely to have any impact on the tribal economy unless vigorous measures are taken to rescue the tribal from the clutches of the money lender. Apart from borrowing money in cash, a system of borrowing in kind is also in vogue in many parts of the country, especially in Maharashtra and Tripura. In Maharashtra, the system is known by the name of Palemod. Under this system, the needy tribals take seed on loan at the time of sowing and return thrice or even four times the original quantity at the time of harvest. Grain taken for consumption during this period or any time during the year is also returned at this rate. Thus, during the harvesting season, a major portion of the crop and sometimes the whole crop is surrendered to the money lender. Likewise, in Tripura, a system called Dadan is prevalent. The creditor purchases the crop in advance at very low rates. I'm leaving some of the lesser important points, and I come to the point of land alienation. The above examples show that the land situation is by no means uniform in all the tribal areas, but there is a lot of uniformity in the ease that most of the tribal cultivators have uneconomic land holdings. Their holdings appear bigger in size as compared with those of non-tribal cultivators, but the vastness of size is nullified by the poor quality of soil, poor techniques of cultivation, and the ever-increasing burden of indebtedness. It seems appropriate to describe the general situation before coming to the crux of the problem, land alienation. Due to spectacular expansion in the means of communication, almost the entire tribal areas were thrown open, and the land and the non-tribal people entered these areas with varying motives. These potential land grabbers among them proved a nightmare for the tribals. I now come to the para that starts with the main reason. The heading is rest and unrest and resistance. The main reason behind tribal unrest and resistance is encroachment on their rights related with land and forest. Because of rampant and chronic indebtedness, millions of tribal people have lost their land to the money lenders and sahukars, and after independence, land alienation has taken place largely due to industrialization and development-induced displacement, and sometimes by the forest department too. Thus, the tribal people are consistently subjected to land, water, and forest alienation as a result of the mainstream invasions, including mega development projects and various other schemes. Here, it would not be out of place to mention two key provisions of the Constitution. Article 14, it states, "The state shall not deny to any person equality before law or equal protection of the laws within the territory of India." Article 46, "The state shall promote with special care the educational and economic interests of the weaker section of people, and in particular the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, and shall protect them from social injustice and all forms of exploitation." At this juncture, it will be in the fitness of things to quote Oliver Mendelssohn and Upendra Bakshi, 1996, who, with reference to the plight of the Dalits and tribal populations, rightly comment that, quote, "While the state can often be conceptualized as a major part of the structure of social subordination, this is not to say that oppression necessarily arises primarily from the state rather than civil society, or that the state has a single an always oppressive character. Yet, if the political authority responsible for governance does not protect the weaker sections from exploitation, the exploited ones cannot be consoled with a plethora of protective and developmental provisions contained in the Constitution, quotes close. The uneven distribution of wealth and power and the continued plunder of resources by the powerful enjoying the state patronage has created a situation which P.D. Sharma described as not only a quote-unquote dualist, but a three-tiered structure comprising of India, Bharat, and Hindustanwa. The bulk of the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes may be included in the lowest tier of Hindustanwa. The most primary among all human rights is the right to life, and this does not mean the right to bare animal-level subsistence. It means right to live with dignity and self-respect. If the resource base of any group or community is encroached seriously and it loses command over the resources without being provided a better or even equal alternative, this sacrosanct human right gets violated. The economic system and social system in a tribal area are indistinguishable. The former, in a way, may be seen as an extension of the latter. Most of the tribal communities heavily depend on the forces of nature which they propitiate by a variety of rites and rituals performed individually or in a group by the community as a whole. The tribal communities have lived in intimate relationship with forests, and their entire existence has been linked with forests due to historical factors. In fact, there existed a symbiotic relationship between them and forests. Forests, for many tribal communities, have been their abode and source of livelihood. Thus, it has been a unanimously held view that forest economy is tribal economy and vice versa. Not only their economic life, but the religious and religio-magical beliefs of the tribal people have been rotating around the forests. Many of flora and fauna have been their objects of worship. It has been seen that in many tribal communities, any endangered species of flora, animals, or birds are declared as totem, and then, as per the religious beliefs, it cannot be killed or damaged. They have their sacred groves in forests from which not even a twig of grass can be removed. This is the tribal way of conservation of forest and environment since times immemorial. The struggle continued, and finally an act called the Scheduled Tribes and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Recognition of Forest Right Act was enacted in 2006. It was popularly called the Forest Rights Act, FRA. It was the result of prolonged intense struggle of Adivasis and became operational with the notification of rules in 2008, which was later amended in 2012. As rightly described by C.R. Bijoy, quote, "This law remarkably attempts to finally liberate the forests, or at least a significant part of it, from the vice grip of a forest governance that treats forest as invaded lands and its people as a subjugated population. This colonial legacy stripped vast tracts of forest of its natural wealth and produced grotesque patches of tree plantations and called it afforestation. It earned disrepute to the forest bureaucracy as a ruthless force. FRA attempts to decolonize and democratize forest governance befitting independent nation." Quotes close. Significantly, this constitutes a threat to the existing power structure. The forest bureaucracy is hostile to the very aim of rights being given to forest dependent communities, while some politicized environmentalists are busy propagating that it will not be good for the forests and environment. They refuse to accept that the biggest stakeholders in the conservation, regeneration, and enrichment of forests are these forest-dependent communities. Forests are their lifeline. Unfortunately, attempts are being made to dilute the act before it has achieved any significant success. Displacement, dispossessing legally. Development, quote-unquote, has become a nightmare for a large number of tribal people. Though it is an established fact that throughout history, rearrangement in human settlement patterns have been a companion of development, but the process should be just, humane, and as voluntary as possible. Development involves changes in land and water use patterns, and in some instances, these changes require the people to be displaced. If involuntary displacement is, to an extent, inevitable, they must be carried out in a way that will protect the livelihoods of the displaced people. If this is not done, then some people shall share the gains, while others only have the pains of the development. This has exactly happened in case of tribal communities. Though the scheduled tribes constitute only about 8% of our tribal population, their percentage among the displaced and ousties is more than 50%. Obviously, it is because of the fact that most of the tribal regions are very rich in natural resources, minerals, water, and forests. The major reasons for large-scale displacement are mining, hydroelectric and irrigation projects, superthermal and nuclear power plants, industrial complexes, military installations, test firing range or weapon testing ground, sanctuaries and parks, railways and roads, and etc. Studies have shown multiple effects of displacement. Involuntary resettlement leads to increased stress, both psychological and sociocultural, and also heightens morbidity and mortality. Another unfortunate outcome is a feeling of alienation, helplessness, and powerlessness. Moving away to new places is just unthinkable to the tribal communities, as they are deeply attached to their ancestral lands. The word resettlement does not exist in any tribal language. The widespread consequences of displacement include dismantling of production systems, desecration of ancestral sacred zones or graves and temples, scattering of kinship groups or network and family systems, disorganization of informal social network that provide mutual support, weakening of self-management and social control, disruption of trade and market links, etc. The more unfortunate part of the story is the case of multiple displacements. Even after having made to give this massive sacrifice, what the displaced people get in return? In most of the cases, they have faced a situation where they did not get jobs in those developmental projects, nor even at semi-skilled levels. When they find that the hydroelectric and irrigation projects get completed, whatever land that remains in their possession does not get any substantial irrigation benefits, nor their villages are electrified to any similar extent. Moreover, whatever compensation they get in cash in many cases gets frittered away on unproductive items, as most of the tribal communities are not savings minded and may not handle or manage the cash judiciously. Thus, first they become landless, then penniless after losing their livelihood. In most cases, the only legislation that is applied is the Land Acquisition Act, which only made the state liable for cash compensation, in the process of legitimizing the gross injustice and social violence. Significantly, the Act only recognized individual and not collective or community rights. What happens to common property resources? It is not compensated for, neither given any alternative. That is why in tribal areas of Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh, especially Bastar region, the tribal leaders and activists may be heard raising such inconvenient questions as, are we a colony of India? If our land and livelihood is taken away in the name of national interest or public interest, are we not a part of the same nation or public? Who will protect our interests? And are we a sacrificial lamb at the altar of progress and development? This is a case where such poetic expressions may be applied. They made us many promises, more than I can remember, but they fulfilled just one. They promised to take our land, and they took it. Had the tribal communities too been made a partner in progress, these problems would not have arisen. The commitment has to be not just for resettlement, but for rehabilitation, which should have been an entitlement and not an act of reluctant generosity. Moreover, the cost of the project should always include the cost to be incurred on resettlement and rehabilitation. All these projects should be open for public debate. Implementation of any project which does not include satisfactory arrangement for resettlement and rehabilitation need to be stopped immediately. Resistance, violence and left-wing extremism. The accumulated consequences of the factors reported in the previous pages, the resistance being witnessed in the tribal belt and adjoining areas stretching from Srikakulam in Andhra Pradesh to Sonbhadra in southern Uttar Pradesh is being seen as one of the most serious problems being faced by the Indian nation since independence. On the basis of its coverage in the media, discussions and debates by the state and civil society, two diametrically opposite perceptions prevail. First, it is posing threat to internal security with national security implications. For those who view it like this, a security-centric law and order approach would lead to a solution, quote unquote. Others view it as a genuine socio-economic problem compounded by exclusion, discrimination, and marginalization of the tribal population. For them, it is a social movement for social justice. Moreover, it is not a problem but consequence of multiple problems faced by the tribal population from the colonial period up to now. It is not a sudden eruption, and its origin and roots may be traced back to the colonial times that witnessed a number of tribal revolts in responses to the oppression and exploitation of the Adivasi population. The gravity of the situation may be gauged from the fact that it has taken under its shadow around 150 districts in around 10 states. It has spread over 25 to 30% of the geographical area of the country. The most affected regions are southern Odisha, south and central Chattisgarh, southern Bihar, Jharkhand, eastern Andhra Pradesh, eastern Maharashtra, and up to southern Uttar Pradesh. The tribal population of the country is around 8% of the total population of India, and almost 50% of the tribal population lives in Bihar and Jharkhand. Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and Telangana, Andhra Pradesh. This means that central India is the largest tribal belt of the country. Significantly, this tribal belt is inhabited by the poorest, the most underdeveloped, and most economically backward tribal population living under severely oppressive conditions. The point not to be missed is that the ultra-left extremism, popularly known as Maoism, is most visible in these areas. The above-mentioned reasons provide the backdrop for the radical extremist movements in tribal areas popularly described as Maoist movement, Naxalite insurgency, tribal militancy, etc. Long years of colonial and post-colonial exploitation have resulted in growing pauperization, oppression, and alienation of these people. The near wholesale loss of control over resources over nearly a century has impeded the development of a middle class within the tribal society. As C.N. Subramanian points out, what we have today is a very thin stratum absorbed into bureaucracy or polity through provisions of reservation. Characteristically, the stratum is keen on disowning its own tribal identity and getting absorbed into the Hindu middle class fold. Now, most of the tribal communities have an elite class among them who are always ready to be used as legitimizers of the state actions. In most cases, the tribal masses are now alienated from their quote-unquote elite, yet the bonds of ethnicity still keep them united despite all these grievances. The expert group of Planning Commission in 2006 came out with a report titled Challenges of Development in Maoist Affected Areas. This report from a state agency is first of its kind in the last 25 years. It has applied an open approach rather than a security-centric one. This report also argues that land-related factors play the most important role in the growth of Maoism, pointing out that thousands of acres of land remain fallow. The expert group has asked the government to devise legal means to ensure that the landless get land. It also recommends that Forest Rights Act be implemented in full earnest in order to ensure people their land rights. It acknowledges that left radicalism has emerged as a result of deficit planning. Constant alienation has made people take up arms, and it is time one understands the problem as just not a law and order problem, but one whose foundations are socio-economic. The report relates extremism to deeper faults in governance, land alienation, unemployment, and inequalities in society. Maoist, Naxalist mobilization have got a lot of attention. All resistant movements by the tribal communities being clubbed together by the state under the category of Naxalite or Maoist insurgency. Given the numbers, the tribal voice will remain marginalized in national politics. Though many of us may not be approving the Maoist way of doing things, but very few people can deny that the Maoist movement has brought focus back on the various issues related to the tribal population, which the successive governments have conveniently sidestepped with their acts of omissions and commissions. Today, the tribal cultures all over the world, including India, are quote-unquote wounded cultures, and it requires an honest and sincere healing touch to our first citizens. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, and thank you, Shatabdi, for helping, sir. So may I now request chairperson of the program to share his presidential remarks.
Good evening. Professor Nadeem Hasnain, Professor Joshiji, Professor Abhi, all my scholarly friends and research scholars. I am very much honored by the invitation of the Kala Kendra, because the most valuable lecture which I have attended today, Nirmal Kumar Bose Memorial Lecture 2018. The title, First Generations, the Tribal at Crossroads. Sir, fortunately, since morning, we are discussing the same issues, even in Sahitya Academy, and now here. Your lecture you have prepared with a great labor and honor. The government of India, who is trying to do justice, how to relocate tribes, how to give education tribal students, how to involve them in agriculture activities. The policies are trying to do that. But as you have raised some questions here, the question of education to tribes is a major issue. Mukhya Dhara and Dhara, mainstream and stream, we are all trying to give them education in the medium of state language. I'm from Karnataka. We are trying to give education to Hasalas, a primitive tribe in Karnataka between Karwar and Goa, in Kannada. It's not possible to teach them in Kannada because Kannada is a foreign language to them. Likewise, a Panika in central India, Baiga in Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh, for them Hindi is a foreign language because they will speak, their parents speak Baigani in their huts, in their locality, in their village. But we are trying to pursue them. You must get education in Hindi. You must get education in Marathi. You must get education in Telugu. Now, why they are lacking behind in education, this is the one reason which you have pointed out. Another one, Jameen. This is all along the way people are talking. the problem started by the East India Company. Before that, Pani never owned by the government. Water owned by the community, the people. The forest owned by the community. Jinko jitna chahiye utna wo lete the. When English people started, aapko a ped kaatna nahi chahiye, a ped kaatna chahiye. Aapko jungle mein itna kilometer jana hai, utna kilometer nahi jana hai. You have to go in such a time, and in such a time you should not go. Now, you know, government is very much fond of declaring as reserved forests, sanctuaries. The first condition of reserved forests and sanctuaries is human should be evacuated from forest. Arey yaar, hajaron barson se sher aur aadmi saath reh rahe the. शेर ने आदमी को नुकसान किया नहीं किया और लोगों ने शेर को नुकसान नहीं किया. दे वर लिविंग टुगेदर. दे हैव डिसाइडेड यू हैव टू वेकेट. नियर बाय आवर यूनिवर्सिटी अमरकंटक, बिटवीन अमरकंटक एंड बिलासपुर, देर इज ए वेरी थिक फॉरेस्ट. नाउ गवर्नमेंट हैज ब्लॉक्ड वन मेजर रोड. In fact, it was digged. No road, no people should not go there. And 168 villages they have ordered to vacate. Where to go? They said, for a family, we are going to give 4 acres of land. Inside the forest, the land was very fertile. Sometime it was, you know, they were with janwar, they were with fruits, jad bootiyan, in sab ke saath the. Now they said, you have to go outside the forest, 4 acres of land will be given to you. It is a bare land. It is a bare land, no tree, nothing. How to live? They have to go to inside the forest at the daytime and to collect minor forest products. And Government of India is so kind enough to declare minor forest products. They are 24 in the whole country. They were enlisted. Aapko kya lena hai, kya nahi lena hai. Thanks to Modi government, in the budget session, they have extended the list up to 50. When I have seen the decision, it is extended up to 50. Immediately I have appointed a working group of our university. We have to first decide, read and see, evaluate the first 24 enlisted groups, and you know, it should be enlisted like this. In Kerala, what are the 24s? In Andhra Pradesh, what are the 24s? At the you know, for example, tamarind in Tamil Nadu is a most valuable product. But in Madhya Pradesh, there is no tamarind. Neem seeds. In Karnataka, it is most valuable. But there is no neem trees in the Central India forests. They should be segregated, enlisted, we have decided, and we should enlist another 26 articles. And we can pursue the government, it should be extended up to 100. It should be extended up to 100. In the first phase, we have sent the list of 100 commodities to finance ministry as well as Niti Aayog. I am trying to convince the tribal minister to take up the issue with the PMO and convince them, the government of India should appoint a working committee to work on this. The thing is, without any expertise, people will sit in the offices at Delhi and they will finalize, decide the fate of 12 crores of tribal people of India. This is how the tribals are ruled by the state governments as well as central government. Sir, I am very much honored by the vision and your labor which you have taken. At the same time, I request the young scholars, we should go into the hamlets of tribal people, in which way they are living. In Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, wherever I go, there are a big hamlet of 52 villages in Mandla district, Dindori district, which is divided now, Bawan Baigachak, Bawan villages, Baigachak. Whenever I will go there, they will ask a first question. VC Saab, hamare paas mobile ka network nahi milta. They are right. They have right to ask. They have right to ask. But since I know the situation, I used to ask them, ye lekar aap kya karoge? Network lekar aap kya karoge? Hamare priorities kya hai? Aapke priorities kya hai? Potable water, shuddh peene ka paani, uski chinta nahi. Shuddh paani milta nahi abhi bhi, kahi bhi nahi milta adivasi jagahon mein, including my university campus. It is mixed with aluminium. Next question un logon ka ye hai ki humko bus aana chahiye gaon tak. Aana chahiye. You know, you have mentioned here modern technologies of agriculture should be introduced to tribes. Kisi bhi raj ne is par kabhi baat nahi ki. Kisi bhi raj ne, including Madhya Pradesh, which is a most, very good government of which I have seen. They are doing the best. But agriculture mein adivasiyon ko kya karna chahiye? Floriculture mein kya karna chahiye? Animal husbandry mein kya karna chahiye? Is par kisi ne dhyan nahi. Then I requested as a vice chancellor, I requested ICAR to give us a Krishi Vigyana Kendra. I fought with the government of India for 2 years. Their question was so simple. Aap विश्वविद्यालय कृषि विज्ञान केंद्र को लेकर क्या करोगे? Finally, I have given an example to the expert committee in Delhi. Our university is giving English education to tribal people. Even we are giving them MA English with 78% without any English. We are giving MSc mathematics with distinction. It's not possible to tell them what is right and what is wrong. So with little experience, I came to know, humko adivasiyon ko jo jis kshetra mein hai, unki expertise hai kus kshetra mein. Us expertise mein unko we have to educate them. I have given an example. It is almost created by me. मैं एक कुलपति होने के नाते एक बार जंगल में गया तो वहाँ कुछ बच्चे खेल रहे थे गायों के साथ बैलों के साथ ये सब तो एक बच्चा बहुत अच्छा लगा तो उनसे कहा कि चलो हम बात करते बेटा हम जंगल के अंदर बात करते गए मैं और बच्चा मैंने पूछा क्या आपको अंग्रेजी आती है मैंने पूछा कि किस क्लास में पढ़ते हो मैं 12वीं में पढ़ता हूँ ठीक वेरी गुड आपको अंग्रेजी आती है उन्होंने कहा कि मुझे अंग्रेजी नहीं आती अरे क्या कर दिया तुम्हारा जीवन नाश हो गया वो चुप रहा फिर आगे बढ़े तो मैंने पूछा आपको गणित, उन्होंने पूछा कि गणित क्या होता है कुलपति जी, गणित क्या होता है। तो मैंने सोचा पूरा जीवन बर्बाद हो गया। फिर हम बात करते करते गए तो मैं पूछता गया केमिस्ट्री है आपको, केमिस्ट्री आप मालूम है, फिजिक्स आपको मालूम है, देश के प्रधानमंत्री कौन है आपको मालूम है, शुद्ध पानी क्या होता है मालूम है। उन्हें कहा कुछ नहीं। उसके बाद हम जंगल में बात करते करते जा रहे थे, मुझे अच्छा लगा, बहुत अच्छा जंगल है। तब तक शेर का दहाड़ने की आवाज़ हुई, तो उस बच्चे ने पूछा वीसी साहब आपको पेड़ चढ़ना आता है? मैंने कहा नहीं, तो भगवान ही आपको बचा नहीं पाएंगे। तो द होल कमिटी स्टार्टेड लाफिंग एंड वी वर ग्रांटेड केवीके। नाउ विद द हेल्प ऑफ केवीके, अमरकंटक के बारे में आप लोग, उसकी मैडम अभी वॉज अवर ईसी मेंबर, कोर्ट मेंबर, वहाँ बहुत सुंदर हवा है। दिल्ली में आपको अच्छी हवा पाने के लिए पैसा देना पड़ता है, वो भी भगवान के भरोसे, मिला तो मिला नहीं तो नहीं मिला। लेकिन वहाँ हमेशा अच्छी हवा, इतनी सुंदर हवा है, अब वो हवा बहुत सुंदर है। नाइट्स आर वेरी प्लेजेंट इवन इन समर्स। सो वी स्टार्टेड कल्टिवेटिंग सम एक्सपेरिमेंटल थिंग्स कि हमको ये करेंगे वो करेंगे, गुलाब करेंगे और यू नो सेंटेड पौधे देखेंगे। उस मे बी 30 प्लांट्स वी हैव स्टार्टेड, 4 आर वेरी इकोनॉमिकली सक्सेसफुल वायबल, और उसका प्लांट्स रेडी करके हम किसानों में हाफ एकर एक एकर बांट रहे हैं। वी आर पुटिंग यू नो मशीन्स टू एक्सट्रैक्ट सेट और एंड वी आर प्लानिंग दैट। आई हैव रिक्वेस्टेड कौशल ministry to give us livelihood incubation center, livelihood incubation center. They were so kind enough. After my 9th meeting, God has given them wisdom, they have granted me. Chalo hamara 2 lakh rupaye pane mein dal diye, chalo lete chalo de diya. Now it is, we are doing extremely well. Matlab हमारी एजुकेशन सिस्टम, कल्चर सिस्टम, मतलब ये है कि अरे आपको गाना गाना है, आदिवासी बच्चों को हम यूनिवर्सिटी में बोलते हैं आपको एक सिनेमा गाना गाना है, उस सिनेमा से ज़्यादा वो कर्मा गाना गाएगा। सिनेमा से बहुत अच्छा कर्मा गाना गाएगा, हालांकि वो सिनेमा के जो जितने भी धुन हैं वो कर्मा गीत के धुन से ही बनी। बट वी आर जजेस, वी आर अनेबल टू जज, नहीं नहीं कर्मा गाना नहीं गा सकते आप। दिस इज द फेट ऑफ ट्राइबल प्राइमरी एजुकेशन, मिडिल एजुकेशन एंड हायर एजुकेशन। आफ्टर बीएससी बीए आई हैव सीन एनालाइज्ड 60% ऑफ ट्राइबल स्टूडेंट्स विल लीव कॉलेज एंड एजुकेशन। Out of 60, they are 55 boys and 5% girls. We have without reservation 42.5% girl students. Out of them are 32 tribal students. They are very eager to learn, but they are not able to cope up with the modern education system, which is unknown to them. In botany, we have made one trial. I requested our botany department. It's a very interesting story. You will be happy to know. There is one tree, maybe 65 kilometers away from our university. It is called as Kalparaksha, very famous as Kalparaksha. The MP of our area once took me, chalo hamare university, hamare kshetra mein, कल्पवृक्ष है नदी के किनारे। मैंने देखी इट्स ए सिंपल पेड़, ये कल्पवृक्ष कैसे हो सकता। देन आई रिक्वेस्टेड आवर बॉटनी प्रोफेसर, टू प्रोफेसर्स, टू एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर्स एंड 5 असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर्स, आप जाओ इसका देखो। दे कुड नॉट मेक इट। देन मुझ में कुछ इंटरेस्ट हुआ कि हो सकता है बैगा आदिवासी उनसे पूछे, तो मैंने कहा कि हमारे पुराणों, ये पुराण का पेड़ है कल्पवृक्ष, तो हमारे पुराणों में इसका इसी तरह इस तरह का जिक्र किया गया है, तो आप क्या बोलेंगे? उन लोगों ने कहा कि सर वो कल्पवृक्ष अलग है, ये कल्पवृक्ष नर्मदा मैया का है, नर्मदा नदी के किनारे है, नर्मदा मैया का है। आप हमारे पूरे देश में घूमिए कि एक ही पेड़ है, कोई दूसरा नहीं, देश तो घूम नहीं सकते। देन आई थॉट इन लोगों का उपयोग हम आम बॉटनी डिपार्टमेंट वाले कैसे ले सकते हैं, वी हैव ट्रेमेंडस इंडिजिनस नॉलेज इन अवर फॉरेस्ट विथ अवर ट्राइब्स। देन रिसर्च स्कॉलर्स वेर एनकरेज टू टेक द हेल्प ऑफ बैगा पीपल हु आर लिविंग इवन टूडे इन फॉरेस्ट, लिविंग विथ हर्ब्स, लिविंग विथ ट्यूबर क्रॉप्स, ईटिंग ट्यूबर क्रॉप्स, जड़ी बूटियाँ खाते हुए हु आर लिविंग। नाउ आवर स्टूडेंट्स आर टेलिंग देयर नॉलेज इज बेटर देन आवर बुकिश नॉलेज, आवर बुक्स। नाउ वी हैव स्टार्टेड टू प्रिपेयर वन ग्लॉसरी ऑफ द नेम्स ऑफ हर्ब्स, नेम्स ऑफ ट्रीज इन बैगाणी, नॉट इन हिंदी, बैगाणी। एक मे बी 30-40 पेजेस दे हैव प्रिपेयर्ड। एक बार मैं उसको देख रहा था, लगभग हमारे संस्कृत ग्रंथों में जो नाम है बैगा लोग उन नामों से ही उसका उच्चारण करते हैं, कुछ लिटिल वेराइटीज, कुछ लिटिल वेरिएशंस, मतलब उनके पास इतनी नॉलेज है। बट ओनली थिंग इज वी हैव टू बिलीव दैट ही हैज़ ए वंडरफुल नॉलेज विथ हिम। He may not be MSc botany. He doesn't know English or Hindi, but he has full of knowledge about the use of the plant. हमारे पास एक पौधा हमने यूनिवर्सिटी में लगा दिया है, बहुत ज़्यादा बड़ा है, उसका नाम है गुड़मार। डायबिटीज के लोग उसको खाएंगे तो उनका शक्कर है ना, वो मार दिया जाता है, गुड़ को मारने वाला। इट्स सो सिंपल। जंगली हल्दी वी हैव, सर इवेंट को, थैंक यू। सफेद मुसली, काली मुसली, दीज आर ऑल दीज मेडिसिन्स आवर ट्राइब्स आर प्रैक्टिसिंग फॉर improving the sight, the problems of eyes. We have a wonderful medicine with our tribal people in Amarakanta. Our modern education, our theories, we are not ready to acknowledge this is a knowledge system. Now, sir, your paper has proved, has forced us, yes, we should accept the traditional knowledge of tribes as the knowledge of the real India. It is pure Bharatiya knowledge system. I am very much thankful to you for your wonderful paper and lecture. At the same time, I request the young scholars visit tribal hamlets, live some time. Delhi, many scholars, sociologists of Delhi, they are living in forests. There are 2-3 people, they have spent their whole life in the jungles of Amarkantak, Mekal jungles and Satpura jungles, this, that. You must come and spend time with the people. Definitely, your research will be benefited, and out of the findings of your research, we Indians will be definitely benefited. With these few words, I express my heartfelt thanks to Professor Nadeem Hasnain, Professor Sachidanand Joshi, and to all. Thank you. Namaskar.
Sir, आपकी इजाज़त से मैं चार लाइन सुनाना चाहता हूँ, जो कहते हैं बहुत रिलेवेंट भी है इस पर। पलामू के एक जंगल में एक ट्राइबल को एक टाइगर मिला। उसने देखते साथ ही अपना तीर कमान उठा लिया। टाइगर ने कहा, रुको, तुम मुझे नहीं मार सकते, इसलिए कि सरकार ने सेफ टाइगर प्रोजेक्ट घोषित कर रखा है। ये कहकर उसने उस आदिवासी पर छलांग लगाई और कहा, लेकिन मैं तुम्हें मार सकता हूँ, इसलिए सरकार ने अब तक कोई सेफ ट्राइबल प्रोजेक्ट घोषित नहीं किया है।
Now I would like to call upon Dr. Ramakarpan sir to present the vote of thanks.
It is my privilege to propose vote of thanks on behalf of IGNCA. We express our heartfelt thanks to Professor Nadeem Hasnain for accepting our invitation and deliver this year's memorial lecture. Sir, your lecture has thrown light on significant issues pertaining to tribal people. I hope that scholars assembled here will give more thought to them in understanding these issues. As concluding the statement of your lecture, you have rightly pointed out that the tribal cultures all over the world, including India, are wounded cultures, and it requires an honest and sincere healing touch to our first citizens. Sir, once again, we are really thankful to you for your insightful talk. Our gratitude to Professor T.V. Tattimani, Vice Chancellor, Indira Gandhi National Tribal University, Amarkantak, who responded to our invitation despite his busy schedule to chair the 9th and 10th Bose Memorial Lecture. Professor Tattimani's observation as chairperson are very relevant. Thank you, Professor Tattimani. Presence of Member Secretary IGNCA, Dr. Sachidanand Joshi, has always been encouraging to us. He provides constant guidance to all our activities and programs. We express our gratitude to you, sir. Our thanks to various divisions and units of IGNCA who have provided their full cooperation and support in arranging today's evening lecture. Last but not the least, our heartfelt gratitude to all those who have responded to our invitation and are with us in this lecture hall. I personally thank each one of you. Thank you. Please join us for a cup of tea.